Good afternoon, everyone. Right now, we're going to have a talk from Graham McAllister from Play Research. Round of applause, please.
There we go. Good afternoon. Hello. My name's Graham. I'm the director of Player Research, which is a UX research and playtesting studio in Brighton in the UK and also in Montreal in Canada. So we do not make games, but it's our job to evaluate games. So all of you or all the companies worldwide who make a game, they should want to evaluate that experience. So how well have you made the game? How good is your game? I would say every studio we work with would say that they have made the best game possible. It's quite windy in here. I hope it stays up. So every studio we work with, and you too, you would imagine you've made the best game possible. You've spent years of your life programming and putting art in, designing the game. But yet, when the game is released, not every game is successful. In fact, all the data will show, we'll look at it today, very few games are actually successful. So why does that happen? All these studios are full of very smart, talented people. But sometimes the games they make are not experienced the way they would want. Why does that happen? So that's what we do for a living. And today, we're going to show you, I'm going to show you, some of the mistakes that companies make when making games. But it's easy to show you the mistakes that bad games would make. So it's easy to pick on a bad game. So we're not going to do that today. In fact, it's quite the opposite. We're going to pick on very good games, games which have been, well, they would be a success, I guess. They get high review scores, lots of downloads, lots of press. But still, those games have UX mistakes in them. Now, one more thing to say before we start. When I say the word UX, the word UX in itself, user experience, it's quite meaningless. If someone says to you, oh, we have someone that does UX, that doesn't actually mean anything. You need to ask UX what? And there are many different types of UX, but the two main ones are UX design or UX research. I'm a UX researcher. So if I say UX today, I'm almost certainly talking about UX research. They're the people who evaluate the design. We do not make the design, we evaluate the design. So that's a very important thing to take away. When someone says UX to you, we have someone that does UX, that's meaningless. They've told you nothing. What type of UX person do you have? Is it a designer or a researcher? And by the way, you need both, probably. But we'll talk about that. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, we're going to show you UX mistakes, design mistakes, in different formats. We're going to show you some mistakes being made in tutorials, in user interface, and in controls or interaction design. So they're just some of the things. Let's start with Cuphead. Has anyone played Cuphead? Oh, wow, okay. It doesn't surprise me. It did very, very well, even though it's only on a few platforms. So Cuphead got amazing press, very high review scores. But it was also in the news for a negative reason, and that's because this games journalist, who you may have seen, played the tutorial, and he live streamed him playing the tutorial. Has anyone watched this? Okay, quite a few people. Okay, so this games journalist, he's 21 years experience in the games industry. He played the tutorial, and he couldn't do it. He could not get through the tutorial for the game. And the web went crazy, and they said, how can this guy with 21 years experience, not just playing games, but critiquing games, and he can't get past the tutorial? Who on earth is this guy? What gives him the right to critique a video game? So this was interesting. Everyone blamed him. This is the point of this section of the talk. Everyone said this guy is an idiot. The player is the problem. Now, as a user researcher, we would never say the player is the problem. Never. It's always the designer, but that's what interested me. The internet said he is the problem. The player is the problem. And if you take this attitude, you're going to miss something. We'll talk about that in a second. Now, I'm going to show you the tutorial. And I'm going to make you watch the whole thing. It's about 3 minutes long, 2.5 minutes, 3 minutes. And I'm going to make you watch the whole thing because it's very uncomfortable. You will feel bad. You will feel terrible. You will feel at this guy, well, the frustration. But when you're watching it, What I want you to do as game creators or students in game design and programming or art, I want you to think about, why is this a problem? Why do you think this guy is finding it difficult? Because that's the job of UX research, is to say, first of all, is there a problem? And why is it a problem? So, by the way, in UX, problems come from two main sources. One of them is the game itself, so the what's on the screen, the information presented, the feedback, the controls, the interface. The other half of the problem comes from what's in here, the human, your expectations, your limitations as a human, your memory, your perception, all of that stuff. So whenever I want you to look at this video, bear in mind you need to think about two things. What's on the screen from the computer side, and what's in the human side. That's why we have the term human-computer interaction. Everything is an interaction, what you see and how you react to it. You need both parts. If you're just thinking of what's on the screen and just thinking of the game, well, you've kind of missed the experience part, because the experience happens in here. You're thinking of technical stuff, but you're not thinking of what you're making. Okay, enough explanation. 2.5 minutes of agony will now start. If you're not familiar with Cuphead, it's a 2D platformer, but it's a very difficult 2D platformer. So this is where all the problems start from. Are you feeling uncomfortable yet? Do you feel his pain? 21 years of experience in game critique, game journalism. Not going well. So again, based on the information presented, why is this a problem? I don't want to influence you, but there's at least six mistakes on this screen. At least six mistakes on this very screen. There's a few more than that, but we'll talk about six of them. So if you're seeing one, you're not seeing the whole problem. Nope, nearly there. So close, so close. Are you feeling awkward yet? Are you feeling his pain? Hurrah! Yay! But it's not over, not yet. The tutorial, there's a little bit more. So this screen is actually okay. This is not too bad. Yep. Right bumper to shoot, all good, not a problem. However, this is a problem. Look at what he's meant to do. Again, I'm not going to show you the results yet. We'll talk about them. So he's failed already. Well, number two. Nope, didn't do that. Once more. Yes. So why did that take so long as well? He took a few attempts to do that. So there's no real problems with this part. In other words, he's able to do what the game wants him to do. But I do want you to think about how many instructions were there. Look at how many things the game presented to him. Phew, so that's the tutorial. That's what he had to go through, and that's what was streamed to the internet. And it did not go well for this chap. So why was that a problem? I'm not gonna ask you, but maybe you saw some of the issues. But let's have a look. So one of the things is language. It says, for example, tap for a short jump and hold for a high jump. Well, that seems reasonable, but how high is a high jump? It doesn't really tell you. It just lets you know two modes are available, a short jump and a high jump, but doesn't tell you how high is high. So just bear that in mind. So dash, bear in mind a dash mechanic is only in a few video games. Only a certain type of video game has a dash mechanic. And if you don't play those games, you may not know what a dash is. So So if you ask 10 people who play video games, how do you dash in a game, or what does dash mean? Not all of them will be able to tell you that. So bear in mind that's an expectation from these designers, that this particular word means something specific. And if you don't know that, that will be a problem for you. Let's go back a little bit, actually. Maybe one more mistake. It says dash, quick evade on ground or air. So, let me see. If you see this, quick evade on ground or air. This is a bad example. He's not actually evading anything in this tutorial. So it's telling you how to do something completely out of context. This is the worst case of tutorial design. By the way, this button does this. I'm not going to show it to you. I just want you to remember it and imagine what it might be like. Okay, thanks for that. That might be useful somewhere. Other problems? One of the issues was he was not aware that he had to use this item. Sorry, he had to jump and then use dash as well. So we had to chain these things together. And some people will make the association and some will not. So these are minor things, but you'll see why this is a problem. So we had to use two things together. Also, the visual reinforcement. This looks like a high jump, but it's not. So they promised one thing, hold for a high jump, and they give you a high barrier, but that wasn't strictly true. So this connection of events. Other language problems. Nullify or interact. What on earth are you talking about? What are these things you're telling me to do? I don't know. I mean, they're technically probably correct from a programming or language perspective, but in terms of trying to teach someone how to play your game, this is by far not the best way how to do these things. Other objects, okay, they've color-coded pink and pink. That appears to be good, but you're about to see another journalist play the game who fails to do that. So this is a problem also. This also builds your super meter. My what? Well, your super meter is this thing here that it doesn't explain at all. So none of these things are explained. Just putting them on the screen is not teaching the player. It's telling the player, but that's different. So each one of these mistakes, each one of these small UX mistakes, even if you're thinking, oh, that's no big deal, the problem is on their own, on isolation, they are no big deal. But when they combine, as in this case, when three or four small UX mistakes combine, they often cause a significant problem. And in this case, you can see many issues combined. The use of language, high in fact was not, high was high? I don't know. Could I practice the high jump? No, you could not. Assume knowledge, well you're gonna know what dash means, right? Actually, no, many players won't know what that means. Some will figure it out and some will not. The visual design, setting the expectation, chaining of instructions, the bad example, and memory overload, cramming all these instructions into the player's head. Hey, here's a bunch of stuff we want you to remember. Good luck. See you in the game. These are not well-designed experiences. This sort of is the idea of someone's made a game and then someone has said, hey, we need a tutorial and we've got 30 minutes free. Could you design something? Yeah, sure. I mean, it's technically complete, but it's very, very far from being brilliant design. So this is another designer, another journalist, also playing the start of the game. So this is the first, I believe this is the first level of the game, a level of the game. And what you're going to see is a problem with the pink. So one of the instructions was these pink objects, you can nullify or interact with them. And he comes along and he's shooting, this all looks normal, it's all fine, all good. And then you see the pink objects and he tries to shoot them. Now you do not shoot them. The tutorial told you, you have to jump and hit jump again to nullify or interact with them. Now the voiceover for this, you'll find it on YouTube. After the journalist tried to shoot them, he comments that, oh, maybe I wasn't meant to shoot them. Maybe I was meant to do something else, which was true. So there was two problems here. One of the ones is he forgot what the tutorial taught him because there were so many instructions going in. The second problem was it didn't look like what it was like in the tutorial. It looked round in the tutorial. It looked spiky here. And actually, there was a third problem. which was his attention was somewhere else. He was trying to play the game, and he was trying to do a voiceover and do all these things. He was probably streaming it. So because of all of these issues, he also missed how the game was meant to be played. Now, you could argue, well, he'll pick it up later on, he'll correct his mistake. Yes, yes, we know, that's fine. And again, I've chosen one of the best games to find mistakes in. The problem is, a lot of games are nowhere near as good as this, and their feedback mechanisms will not put the player back on track. They teach the player poorly and do not correct the bad behavior. And what happens is, players often think, well, I'm doing the right thing, because the game told me so. But I can't win, so I suck at this game, they get frustrated, and players leave. That is the ultimate effect of these sorts of issues. The player will leave your game. They will not think it's as good as you think it is, because they will not play it correctly. So each of these issues may be small, but bear in mind, our job is to make great games. When we do the UX research on a game, we're trying to find, is the player going to play this the way the designer wants? If the designers want the player to play it like this and have an unpleasant time in the tutorial, that's okay, that's their choice. But if they don't want that, then that's not okay. And also, these decisions they have made, the design decisions, show that they're not thinking like the player. They're making lots of assumptions. And UX research, the core point of UX research is to say, do not make assumptions. It's okay to identify an assumption. We think the player will like this. We think the player will understand this. We think the player will do this. You should be making those assumptions when you make your game. But you should also be evaluating those assumptions and ticking them off before release. Yes, players will get through the tutorial. Players know how the core mechanics work. Players know why they should come back and play again, because this thing's going to come up. Players know how the feedback mechanic works. If you're not ticking those things off, and you make assumptions about what the player will or will not do, it's probably not going to end well for you. Okay, so let's just reinforce some of those things. Even in this one screen, as I was saying, the problem was not that these issues were major. Of course they weren't major. If they were major, the developers probably would have fixed them. They were minor, but there were six minor issues in one very place which caused the problem. The holding for the high jump. This journalist thought he was doing the right thing. Tap for short, hold for high jump. The visual reinforcement almost looks like tap for this, hold for that. And because this instruction looks very, very clear, that's why you saw him try it many times. He thought he was doing exactly what the designers wanted him to do. But it wasn't quite like that. They also expected you to figure out quicker that you should, you know, also stand on this block and do the dash mechanic. All of those three things had to happen at the same time, and only then would you succeed. So again, these problems are compounded. Dash, visual reinforcement, the bad example, the chaining of commands, the fact you have to stand on the block. When you add them all together, little small mistakes add up to a bigger mistake. Your game will have these too. It'll have small mistakes, sometimes it's not a problem. If they happen to align, well, that's a different story. I used to be an academic. If I was still an academic, this is a D-. This is students, you have not been paying attention to the human. You may be able to program something and get it on the screen. Awesome, good for you, but it's not the recipe for a good game. It's not the recipe for a great user experience. We're interested in the detail. We're interested in saying that is not good enough. And you'll see examples later on. They're good, but they could be better. That's the very thing we're interested in. Do you not want to be the best of what you could be? I'd be surprised if anyone doesn't. Of course you want to be the best. You're going to put years of your life into making games. Everything can be better. And the thing is, although everyone says that, some of them are more, there's a better process, there's a better way of identifying these issues. Okay, so back to the key point, which was, why did no one blame the designers? When you read the comments online, it's always, wow, this guy's an idiot. Why is he critiquing games? I didn't hear one person say, maybe that design wasn't good enough. I didn't see one person say that. So just as a general thought exercise, I would like to know, you know, why? Why did no one say, actually, yeah, they maybe could have done a better job. How did the design feel? So that was tutorials. I'm going to move on to UI. Some people say UI, UX together. I'm not a fan of combining these two things. The reason being, if you put UI, UX together, it kind of reinforces that UX is about the visual layer. And it's, well, it's one small part of it, but most of the experience is inside your head. It kind of tries to bypass the human. So I am certainly not a fan of saying UI, UX, whatever. It's either visual or something else. Again, be specific. What are you talking about? If you're talking about UI, that's fine. If you're talking about interaction design, that's fine. If you're talking about information architecture, that's fine. Be specific. But saying these general terms like UX, well, I don't know what you're talking about. Please tell me precisely. So this is a critique of UI design and base builders. So these are four games. We have Clash of Clans, Boom Beach, Game of War. Whoop. Okay. Oh, is it going to work? Maybe. Let's try again. Anyway, Game of War Fire Age, lower left, and lower right, we have Star Wars Commander. Three of these games are reasonably very successful. So Clash of Clans, Boom Beach, and Game of War are successful for different reasons. Star Wars, although it looks visually similar, has not been very successful, at least not in the same league as these other ones. And what was interesting is Star Wars was released much long after these other ones, so they had time to study what was good about these games, and they had the Star Wars IP to put on top. So we're going to give you that game that you like, that style of game, and make it with Star Wars. Surely that's a recipe for success, right? Didn't work. Wow. So we spent some time trying to figure that out. How can you not put Star Wars onto an already successful genre and make it even more exciting? Well, the answer is it's not a very good game. That's one of the reasons it comes down to. But the interesting thing is why. And it's a long discussion, but I'm only going to show you UI stuff today. So one of the things is, let's talk about player trust. This is for mobile games. I'm not sure what games you're making, but in the mobile world, if you've played any free-to-play games especially, whenever you open the game and play a session, you'll get a reminder saying something like, this really isn't going to work, is it? No. It's really not going to work. Anyway, so you'll get a pop-up reminder like this saying, please turn on notifications. We want to remind you and bother you and interrupt your day. And most people say, no, I don't want to be interrupted. Please go away. So some of the games here would still do that. They give you this system iOS notification saying, hey, turn on notifications. And most players say no. And that sounds like a really small thing, right? Just don't bother me. The problem is, if you want retention, if you want the player to come back, you really want the notification to be turned on. You want players to come back to your game, play more sessions. So Star Wars Commander, despite not being a great game, I know you can't read this, but it says things like, hey, would you please turn on notifications because we want to send you a field report. This will tell you when you're under attack and you'll be able to make better decisions. So it basically says, please turn on notifications because you'll be more successful in the game. We'll send you a field report. A field report sounds awesome. I want that. So these are the same thing. These are exactly the same sort of message. Star Wars, explain it to you in a way that you care about. Do you want a field report of your game to make you better in battle? Yes, please. Please send me that. The other one says, iOS dialogue, can we send you notifications? No, that's really boring. I don't want you to bother me. So these people, thinking like a programmer, we have presented a dialogue box. It technically works. Good job. No, it's terrible. The Star Wars Commander people were trying to make it more human. Why do we want people to turn on notifications? Because it's related to game retention, because it relates to people coming back. Same sort of principle, but done in a completely different way. People do not trust these dialogues. It sounds like you're spamming them. This is building trust. We want you to be better at the game. Please turn it on. Yeah, I want to be better at the game too. And this is one of the first things the player will see. What about icon design? In fact, spatial placement of icons. So if you're playing things like Star Wars Commander, you'll see these icons up here. They both appear in the lower left-hand corner. The problem is with these two icons, these two here, they work in completely different ways. So one is an extra ability or a consumable, and one is not. But they're both in the same part of the screen, and they look like you would use them in the same sort of way. But it's not true. If you look at Boom Beach, it does a visual displacement. So this object is completely separated from this one because they do not want you using this by accident. this is an additional ability or a consumable. If you use this by accident and lose it, you're going to be very upset with the game. I didn't mean to do that. But yet, Star Wars chose that design. They put the two things beside each other, increasing the chances of you using the object incorrectly. Why would you do that? Why would you try to upset your players? It also increases the recognition. It speeds up decision making. These objects behave like this. These objects behave like this. Trips have special abilities and consumables. They're trying to help you as a player to make a better decision. But again, Star Wars is not helping the player. They're just thinking, have I programmed it? Yes, you've programmed it, but it's not enough. Help the player play the game correctly. Other examples from Boom Beach. You want the player to make meaningful decisions as quickly as possible. You want the player to make smart decisions. But what you don't want is the player to make a decision and then regret it. That is not going to end well. The player is likely to be upset and maybe leave or not pay you again or leave a negative review or not tell their friends. So if you upset the player or frustrate them, it doesn't go well. So look at the visual design that Clash of Clans does. In these potions, they all look incredibly similar. Do I want to use the blue bottle, the orange one, or the green one? Well, they all kind of look the same, and I have to remember which is which. Why would you make the player remember? When you look at Boom Beach from the same company, these icons all reflect the real world, a medical kit, a smart bomb. They're helping you remember. The visual design helped you remember what they do. That's much, much better. So this is better for decision making. It's better for reducing error. All sorts of reasons. This is the last one for UI design. So in Star Wars, again, these items, apart from the first one, they all look very, very similar. And they're all on brand. They all look like Star Wars ships. But they don't work the same way. And imagine you want to make a fast decision. Which one do I apply? If you're a Star Wars nerd, yes, you may know which one is which. But for the average gamer who just wants to know, which one did that thing again? They're not helping the player to make a better decision, a faster decision. They're not helping the player to reduce error. In fact, they're increasing the chances of error. Not the best decision making. So completely on brand, but not good for the player. So again, when we think of UI, you need to think of not just the visual layer. You need to think, what does this UI cause in the player? So some of the principles you need to think about. Have I established trust? Am I going to increase the chances of the player making an error? Have I put too much on their memory? Our memories are not good. Don't try and shove stuff into the player's head that's not necessary. It fails a lot, as you will see in your final exams, no doubt at some point. Your memory will fail you. I'm sorry to say it. And why not improve recognition? If the visual design matches the real world, that is a better visual metaphor than just saying, here's a bunch of stuff that looks nice. UI is not about how things look nice. It's about how it behaves. It's about helping the player make a decision fast, without error. That's good visual design. The idea of graphical polish means it looks better is, that's not what we mean. Polish is about, is it helping the player to make the right choice at the right time without error? That's what you want. Okay, the last one we're going to talk about is controls. So we talked about tutorial design. We talked about UI design. What about mistakes in control design? This is an iOS game called Atomine. It's a twin stick shooter. Here's a quick video. They have three different control schemes in the game. That's always a sign of concern, but anyway, let's have a look. This game is highly reviewed, by the way. Again, I'm picking games which are good to find flaws in. The ones that are average, we could talk all day about that. So this is, I'm sure you've all played twin stick shooters, but the left stick is to move your character and the right one is to shoot in the direction. So what's the problem with this? Well, this is quite good. It's quite good, but it's not brilliant. So in this design, you can see that this is me moving my finger, my thumb, and when I move it a great distance, it draws a new circle. You want that, that's good. So when I move a great distance, the character shouldn't move. You don't want unintended interaction. The problem with this design is, if I take my finger off the screen and put it down only a small distance away, the character moves a little bit, and I don't want that. So again, I'm trying to show you something about feeling, which is not, it's difficult to describe. But it's all to do with these small movements. If I do a big movement with my thumb, there's no problem. You'll see the analysis in a second. So that's what they call normal controls. And it's good, but it's not the best. We then have static controls, which is nearly always terrible. So if you're making a twin stick shooter on a tablet, please do not do this. It is not the best design. You'll see why in a second. So in static design, they fix these to the screen. And no matter where you put your finger, it doesn't matter. They want you to put them in these locations. This is the worst, probably the worst design. By what I mean is, you get lots of unintended movement. When you take your finger off and put it back on, you get character judder. It moves a little bit. Last one. I thought they were nearly going to be brilliant. I thought they had discovered the secret. This is the secret to the best controls, where in hidden twin stick shooters, when you take your finger off, the circle also is removed from the screen. And this is what you want. However, they made a mistake. Although they stopped showing the controls, this one actually behaves just like the first one. All they did was when you take your finger off the screen, they stopped showing it. But that's not quite what you need. So what's the problem here? That's three different control schemes, and none of them is the best. And what's interesting is they developed and coded three different control schemes, and they didn't need to. This could have been done from almost a mathematical analysis. If you Google for my name and Gamma Sutra and twin stick controls, I wrote a really boring long article analyzing twin stick shooters on touchscreens. And I explained, you don't need to do any coding. This is an interaction design problem. This is mathematical. It's almost what goes up, what goes down, what moves. And you can work out your best controls with almost no prototyping. You just need to think. Who would have thought? Thinking actually helps. So this was their first control scheme. Your thumb goes down, your thumb goes up, and when you put your thumb down again, if you put it down within the region of the circle, your character will move a little bit as the game thinks you want to move. You don't want to move. You just put your thumb back down on the screen. So what happens is the screen flutter. Your character will move, unintended. But with it, if you move it outside the circle, it's fine. It draws a new circle. So not smart. The solution to the problem, which they nearly got, was you hide it on release. When you take your thumb off, you hide the circle, and then no matter where you put your thumb down, that's the new center point. It's a simple, that's all you have to do. So one small design decision makes the player feel great. Wow, this feels really fluid and smooth. And the other one makes the player think, something's not right, but I don't know what. And if you look at the iOS reviews, the players think the controls are good. Again, I'm not interested in good. I'm interested in the best. And these are not the best. They're good. They're good enough, maybe. But that's not the world we're in. You know. So again, you may say, oh, come on, really? One decision and you're nitpicking this design? It's like, yeah, because it feels janky. It feels awful. It's unintended player input. I did not decide to move this character. The game decided to move that character. That's a poor design decision. And if you're not interested in these details on your game, you should probably choose another career. Because game design is about very, very small and meaningful decisions. When people say a game design is great, it's because they thought about you. They thought about the player. It's better for the player. That's what we want. Please make really great design choices that make me feel good, and I will keep playing your game forever. But if you make enough bad decisions, I will play your game for 30 seconds and go, I don't like it. So that's why these things matter. Okay, very, very quickly. How common are these issues? Well, when I was an academic, I had a master's student at the time, and she analyzed hundreds of game reviews. And we were looking for evidence. Why do games suck? That's what it comes down to. And when people review a game, either professional critics or you, when people review games on forums or on Metacritic, doesn't matter where it is, what sort of things do they talk about? So why do they say a game is good, and why do they say a game is bad? And there were five main categories. So one of them was technical, QA, frame rate, bugs, all that sort of stuff. But the other four were all about the human experience, or the user experience. Not surprising, that's why we play games. But there were four different categories. So one is usability, which is what I was talking about with the control scheme. Can I do what I want to do? Well, sort of, but now and again there's unintended input. I didn't want that. So that's a usability issue, that's a controls issue, also a camera issue. There's game components. The thing that the designer wants me to do, are they interesting? Is there depth to them? Maybe, maybe not. Expectations, we see this all the time. It's a certain game in a certain genre, and if you do not meet the player's expectations, then that's a problem. They're disappointed immediately, and you may never get them back. So are you going to meet players' expectations? Oh, the game doesn't do this. But that's common in this genre. Why do you not do that? And the last one's user emotions, which is, whenever I use the game components, how does it make me feel? Do you feel powerful? Do you have agency? Can you make decisions that matter? How do you feel when you play games? So these four UX issues are pretty much what game reviews are. That's why we praise or critique games. And this went on, so we were looking for evidence, does UX matter in games? And also, how frequent are these errors? Another way of thinking about this is this layered model. So this is the model we use in the company, a player or something similar to it. If your game is premium, that's fine, you don't need to worry about the fifth layer. But these layers will impact on your game. So when you're thinking, have we made a good game? That sounds like a binary condition. Have we made a good game? Yes, no. And obviously that's not true. It may help you to think of your game in these layers. Is our game interesting? Is it even, you know, could be visual, could be the idea, could, who knows? Can players learn to play the game? The tutorial, that's why I showed you Cuphead. Is the usability good? The twin stick shooter controls. Is it fun to play or meaningful or enjoyable? And finally, you have this monetization layer for free-to-play games. You may have seen this layer before, this model before. It's often used in investigating accidents. So when planes crash and stuff like that, this is the problem. Planes go down, cars crash, boats sink. In video games, you have, our game didn't get enough downloads. We made no money. Or no one's playing our game. No one's interested in our game. That's the problem. But what this model says is, it's not just the player experience layer. It's not just that your game isn't fun. The problem is probably that each layer of your game has a small problem. And when they add up, it's actually a big problem. So your game isn't interesting enough. There are too many other games like it. I've seen it before. Or I don't know how to play it. Or I can't do it. Or the mechanics aren't interesting. So when it comes to the stage of asking for money, would you give the developer some money for this experience? The answer is often, no, I will not. But that doesn't mean your game is not good enough. Actually, your game could be great, and the problem most often is in these two layers. We work on 80 games a year, mostly the top games in the world, and most of their problems are here. The idea for the game is usually great. It's not a problem. It's just getting the player to the idea is a massive problem. So you need to think, the problem with these is that these issues do not appear in analytics. There's no way of knowing them. They're inside someone's head. You have to actually observe a player and then talk to them in a structured way to figure out, we have watched you do the wrong thing. Now I need an explanation for that. So behavior is your strongest data source. Asking players to justify it, not so good. Asking players to talk is not so meaningful. You really want to watch them. What did they do? And then interview them to figure out, why did they do that? Why did they think that was the right way to play the game? Another way of looking at this is like the game breakout. You want the good stuff at the top. Hey, we want successful games, millions of downloads. We want a successful company. Yes, I know. But bear in mind, these barriers are in the way. And unless you tick off these lower layers, you're going to find it very, very hard to get to the good stuff, which is good games with plenty of money. And people love what you made. We're getting to the end, I'll speed up a little bit. So this is back to what I said at the start, that the term UX on its own is almost meaningless, and you need to ask UX what? So the most common term when people say UX is they mean this, UX design. And the UX designer's job is to speak to the game designer, what do you want to happen? And then they will translate that to what's on the screen. That's fine. But UX research is actually 2/3 of the design process. UX research says, did you do a good job? This is making stuff, this is the game. this is the thing you made, is it any good? So what amazes me is I speak to about 300 game studios a year, roughly, and most of them are very, very poor at those two. So before you design your idea, do you know why players do what they do? So say you're making a new match three or a new base builder or a new MOBA or a new first person shooter. Do you know why players first are playing your competition? What do they enjoy about that? Did they make a purchase? Oh, they didn't, why not? Or they did make a purchase, were they satisfied with the purchase? Why do people do what they do? You're meant to understand people first and games. So this comes in two halves, games, humans. You take that information, based on what you figured out, you design something, then you measure, well, what we made, was that successful? No, let's go back again. So design is actually three steps, but in the games industry, design is mostly, not all studios, focus on this one, which is the creation of the idea. That's the game design. Not quite, that's part of design. The creation part, that's great. You should have an idea, but bear in mind you need to measure it too. The guy who coined the term UX, a guy called Don Norman, he said, for any mathematicians, I know the formula doesn't work. It's fine, don't worry about it. But he says, if you're doing UX and you're not actually involving the user, then you're not doing UX. That's called making stuff up. That's fine, just be aware of that. So if you say you're in UX but not actually involving the human, the you, well, you can't have UX. You can't just take the bits you want. It doesn't work like that. This is how we do it in player research. So these five layers that I said are important to games, these are the methods we use at each stage of development. So during the idea stage, during design, during production, and then live operations, we have different methods at different times. And the reason is we're trying to remove the assumptions. We've got a good idea, cool, let's figure it out. We've got a cool design, cool, let's try and find out the mistakes you've made. What about the gameplay? So if you want to know, for example, if you want to polish usability and tutorials or learnability, you have four different methods that will do that. And the reason you have four methods is because they work at different times of the life cycle. You don't have to wait until you've got a final playable. You should be fixing lots of mistakes when it's on paper. That's one of the great mistakes of the game industry. We're not ready yet. yeah, you're ready years ago. This is a slide to show you from the user researcher, so the guy who does my job but was in Bungie. When he worked on Halo 2, this is the user, the play testing they did before release. So 17 months before release on Halo 2, they did some play testing and then a batch, then some near the end. On Halo 3, a lot more, and on Destiny, 48 months before release, so 4 years before release, they were starting. So if you ever say we're not ready, it means you're not making the game the best way you could. You're going to let that assumption get further into development than what it could do. So this is, you know, billion-dollar franchise. Did they want to make guesses? No, they're trying to remove assumptions. Don't guess. That's what they're trying to say. I'm going to skip over this example, but just to say very, very quickly, this is a game we worked on called Heat Signature. It's a PC game. It's now been released by Tom Francis. And he, at the early stages, he had a new idea for a control scheme. And he says, I'm going to completely change this control scheme for an FTL type game. But before he made that control scheme, before he released the control scheme, he said, let's test it. And we did a play test just focusing on controls. And we give players two options. We had the new and improved control scheme that he had designed, and he thought players would love. And then we had the traditional WASD. Long story short, nobody liked the new control scheme. They all felt out of control, the player wouldn't do what they wanted, and WASD was completely satisfactory. So it turns out the standard way was not only what players expected, but it was actually better as well. And we asked players, by the way, you can switch between them freely, and you can go back to the other scheme if you want. And only, I don't think it was only one player, none of the players chose to do so. So this was interesting. This is a success. He tried something new and innovative. He tried to design something new to make the player feel great. But it didn't work. But at least he had evidence. Instead of thinking, I've got a new control scheme and I'm going to release that and everyone will love it, that would have been a huge mistake. But he caught this early in development. Cool. Nobody has this. You'll never play that version of the game. That's fine. That's a success. Okay, we're in the final slides, I think. So I was mentioning earlier that I speak to around 300 studios a year. And sometimes I ask the question, why do you think your game will be a success? I'm genuinely interested in the question. And sometimes, or a popular response is this, that they kind of average out the people. We have great programmers, we have great artists, we have great designers. So on average, we think we're going to make a good game. The team is good. That's a common response. And it sounds logical, right? These are the ingredients we have. The ingredients are good, so the outcome is going to be good. The problem with that approach is it's only focusing on what you see, what you think you have. But that's not exactly the whole picture, because I showed you the three bubbles for design. And design is actually three steps. It's not making stuff up. Design is evaluating and understanding as well. So most of these studios are very, very poor at this thing that they don't know about. And the issue is, when their game is released, their previous games, the design that they thought they were strong in is actually quite weak, but they didn't know. So the overall ratings for their game, the feedback on their games, they're not often well received, because they don't actually do the checking part. They do the bits they want. There's lots of reasons for it, I know. So another way of looking at this is diminishing returns, the idea of polish. You should make the game you want, of course you should. All the stuff, all the effort. But then there's a stage where you have to polish a little bit, okay. And then a lot of studios do this, which is we're polishing. We're either adding features or just polishing what we have. And the problem with this is that if you're doing this, it means you're not doing something else. You do not have infinite money. You don't have infinite people. And if you're choosing to polish something that's not important to the player, it means you could have been doing something else. One of the most famous examples of this is from Naughty Dog. And they had a problem in production for one of their games. Actually, several probably. But this is a quote, you can Google the story, it's public. That's just about the dangers of focusing on the wrong area. It's saying, this guy was drafted in the middle of development, and he said, why are you focusing your time on this thing, which is really good, when this other area of your game is really poor? Why are you choosing to do that? So one of the things about UX research is it helps you focus on what matters to the player. Here's a report on your game. Here's feedback on your game. By the way, you were going to fix that feature today. Nobody cares about that feature. But this thing over here, nobody can figure it out. You're focusing your attention in the wrong place. So you need that feedback to say, what do we do today to move the needle the most? We know everything will make the game better. But is it the thing you should do? Well, I don't know. Thank you. Do we have time for questions? I'm not sure.
Where is it?
Okay, so hey, thank you for coming. I was wondering, I have two questions actually. The first one is if you have any experience with serious games, where some faculty or university came to you and said, here we have this serious game, we need to teach kids about bullying or something like that. And how would you critique something like that?
We've worked with one serious game around the idea of, I'll not mention, it's not public, but yes, we worked with one. Some of the principles still apply. Bear in mind, most of our job is on the fun games for enjoyment, let's say. And that's why we have those five layers. But for serious games, those lower layers still apply. So does the player understand the benefits of doing, you know, whatever the game is making them do? Can they learn the basics? Is the feedback, you know, effective in teaching them the principles? So those lower layers still apply to any sort of game, either a serious game or it's just for the games for fun. We have this, I should say the idea of fun is more difficult to measure. It's much more difficult because it's more subjective. But things like usability or cognition, how you learn, they're closer to the objective scale, because we can ask someone to explain how something works, and either you understand or you don't. So it's quite binary. So it's an easier problem, if you like. What you may run into with serious games is things like, if you're trying to change behavior, that can be difficult to measure itself, but the easier stuff is, can they understand what they're meant to be doing? But, so it's not really our core business, let's say.
I imagine, okay. So my other question is, has a junior game developer or some guy that worked in and did some game jams, what would be your advice or some tips to improve our game? Would it be like be constantly user testing our game through I don't know, a jam? Like we have 48 hours to make a game. do we hire someone to come every 2 hours to play the game? Or what would be any tips or advice to give?
You know, it depends what you want. So Google Ventures, GV, they have a process called Sprint, and there's a book called Sprint by Jake Knapp. And we often wondered, could we use that process as a way of leading into a game jam? So one of the problems a lot of companies have is, what game should we make as the idea for the game? And everything I talked about today is evaluating the game. You know, have you done it right, essentially? But if you take a Sprint process, it's meant to bring people in and get the ideas from them to help you generate ideas. So if you look up the Sprint process, that may and do that before your game jam, that may help you generate an idea to bring into that and make your time more effective. So that's something we've wanted to do, haven't had time to do yet. Yep.
Next question. Raise your arm.
Thank you. Are you familiar with the video game industry crash of the 1980s?
Sorry, just could you repeat that?
Are you familiar with the video game industry crash of the 1980s?
Of the 1980s?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I personally feel that a lot of the factors, a lot of the reasons why the industry crashed back then are in place today, basically. It's like, do you feel that it's the industry today is running the same danger, basically?
That it's about to crash or possibly?
Yes. One of the reasons it crashed back then was we had a lot of games that offered poor user experience. So you could say that the same thing applies today.
So I'll try and repeat the question to make sure I understand. In the 80s, we had the crash of the games industry. Mm-hmm. I know people blame E.T. and things like that, which probably isn't true. But and you're saying, do I think there's going to be a crash in the games industry?
Basically, do you feel that there's going to be another crash in the near future? And if so, would it be healthy even for the industry to experience another shot like that?
My goodness. I tend not to think about those questions, dare I say. I personally don't think so. If you ask me to offer an opinion, I don't think we're going to crash. In fact, all the data says it's increasing. If you read the market reports on the future, no, it depends what you mean by a crash. In terms of revenue, it appears to be increasing. And all the predictions are increasing as well. So it depends on if you're hinting at things like, do we have too many games? Well, it depends. If you have too many, you could have too many games in one genre, for example, and maybe only one or two of them will succeed. But niches tend to do very well. You don't need to be in the top charts to succeed. There's a developer, Zachtronics, for example, who make programming games. If anyone hasn't played Shenzhen IO or TIS 100, I think there's many programmers in here. They're an incredibly niche game. It's a game around assembly language programming. How niche can you get? And they do very well, but they're not mass market. So I think those games should exist. They're incredibly niche, but they speak to a certain audience. So I'm not too sure what a crash would look like today. But again, it's not a question I think about an awful lot, personally. I think discoverability is definitely a problem, but I also think there's a lot of very poor video games. Like when we assess not only the ones we work on, but other games out there, they're not great games, a lot of them. So you could say, do they deserve to fail? Are they experts in their craft? Well, probably not. Could they learn in the future? Yes, maybe. Can I turn the question around? Why do you think we're heading for a crash, or why would that be a good thing? Or
it's more of a personal thing. Basically, I feel like I'm getting tired of video games. I'm seriously tired of video games. I feel like there's too many, and I don't know how should I put it, but I feel like we get a lot of crap nowadays.
Yeah.
Yes,
I'd agree.
I've been playing video games all my life, and I think I'll be doing so until the day I die, basically. But I'm getting bored of seeing the same crap over and over.
But there's good games as well, right? Even great games.
Yeah, but like for every good game, it feels like you're getting 20.
But you don't have to play them all.
If you have a good look at the Steam front page, you get flooded by, well, crap, basically.
So, I mean, there's lots of issues in there, but I mean, do you feel you need to play them all? I mean, I play a lot of games for research, but I only play maybe 5 in any great depth in a year. So I'm choosing very carefully where I spend my 60 hours in a game, or 40 hours, whatever it is.
Well, it's kind of hard to make up your mind because you're getting flooded with all those free-to-play games on mobile, and now on PC or main consoles. So I'm overwhelmed by games and I get bored of just seeing them or playing them. Maybe I just wish that the industry would crash. Maybe it's more of a personal desire.
I think we'll park it there, I think, because there's so much to say on that. There's lots of stuff, but it's an interesting thought exercise. Yeah, but I don't think we're crashing. No, that's the short answer.
Okay, so I got one more. Sorry.
Go on then.
So I was thinking about games such as Limbo, where sometimes the player has to make an error. So you started your presentation with something where a player should learn the basics of the game. Mm-hmm. What about when it's the opposite, where the player should make an error? Does the design changes? Does it just invert?
Yeah,
or are there different?
So Limbo is one example where it's perfect. I would argue there is a tutorial. It's just not the way people think of tutorials. The reason with that is it's got perfect feedback. You do something and it tells you, please don't do that. That's not good. And you go, okay. So Limbo's one of the best tutorials. It just doesn't say pop-ups in. But the feedback is part of the tutorial, don't forget. I mean, it's just teaching you how to play, and it's very successful at teaching you how to play. So it's great design. Yep.
So if I wanted to make a game similar to it, where the player has to make mistakes, I couldn't just reverse the tips that you showed us. Or could I? Or should I just be careful where the player is paying attention and then make something come out of the space where he's not paying attention?
It depends what you want. I mean, if you want the player, the games that do that, they want the player to explore, right? Part of the game is, please go and explore this world. And if you do it wrong, we will tell you very clearly what you're meant to do or not to do. And if that's part of your game design, if that's what you want the player to do, then that is fine. But Cuphead's about, you know, it's about careful interaction control. It's a 2D, a difficult 2D platformer. So it's meant to tell you very clearly, here's what you do, and I go off and it's about controls, right? And your response and Super Meat Boy and those sorts of games. So it depends, comes back to what do you want the player to do in your game? I'm not a designer. Greg, who's talking next, is a game designer. He'll tell you much more than I would. I'm the guy who measures the design. But we do ask designers often, what do you want the player to feel? What do you want the player to do? And then we measure that. So it's always about what do you want the player to do, and then the part of the playtest is saying, did the player enjoy that exploration? If you want them to explore your world, after playing it, are they then playing the game correctly? Because if that doesn't work, you've went wrong somewhere. So, yeah.
One last question.
So, good afternoon. I hope you're enjoying Lisbon. I wanted to make you a... Can you hear me?
Yeah, it's really noisy, sorry.
Yeah, so I wanted to make you a question about, I really like what you said about getting into the user or the player's mind. Mm. I really think that's the golden goose. And I was wondering what kind of techniques do you use, such as eye tracking or some kind of physiological tracking? It's merely statistical.
No. There's no numbers. We don't draw graphs. No. I'm not interested in graphs at all.
Okay.
So the methods that we use are mostly, the people I hire are mostly PhDs in psychology or neuroscience. So people who study humans, essentially. Behavior is your strongest source. So what people do is by far the best measure because you can't argue with it. They did it or they did not. So when we run a play test, we observe the player. We're never in the same room as them. They're in their own. They play the game. Our psychologists would observe them remotely. Usually two psychologists would observe that one player, what they do, and then they would interview the player based on what they do. Because obviously the player is a mental model. They think in their head, I know how the game works.
Yes, but then you have to process all this data.
No data.
So the psychologist report, you ask them to make like a summary of it. How does it work?
So normally it's observation. So they're making notes on the human observation behavior, and there's two of them. So they agree that the two psychologists would agree this is what the player did. and they're very specific, and then they interview to uncover why was that a problem? Why did the player think? We do that across about 6 players, and that's enough to get a reasonable understanding of, are people playing your game correctly? Now, the other question you're asking about numbers is, do they like your game? So if a developer says, do they like your game? Ah, well, that's 36, we test with 36 people. So that's a numbers, a quantitative method. So there's 2 main methods, and we start with qualitative, and then we move to quantitative. That's a whole separate talk. But we used to use eye tracking, we fiddle with physiological responses. We don't use any of that stuff these days. It's expensive and slow, and it's probably not going to reveal anything you'll get from actually just looking at the player. Yep. It's interesting, though. Yep.
So this is the last question. If you guys have any more questions, Graham will be at the showcase. Don't miss out the last talk of the day from Greg Street from Riot Games. Give one last round of applause for Graham.